All right. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Unity Spiritual Center. We're going to start out with a song called Every Day's a Holy Day. So I invite you to stand up and sing along.
Every day's a holy day. Every day's a reason to celebrate. Every day's is a holy place. Give thanks, give praise. Every day is a holy day, and we're rising up this holy day.
I'm going to repeat that verse. Here we go.
Every day is a holy day. Every day is a reason to celebrate. Every place is a holy place. Give thanks, give praise. Give thanks, give praise. 'Cause every day is a holy day, and we're rising up this holy day. Shine like the sun. We rise every moment. We have become.
We become one.
Every day's a holy day. Every day's a reason to celebrate. Every place is a holy place. Give thanks, give praise. Every day is a holy day, and we're rising up this holy day.
Because every day
is a holy day, and we're rising up this holy day.
Good morning, Unity.
Good morning.
I feel risen. Do you feel risen? Let's welcome Reverend Gordon Kyler.
Good morning. Do you feel risen?
Yeah.
I do too. Is there anybody here for the first time that's comfortable raising your hands and letting us see you? Welcome. We are so glad you are here with us today. And we want to say to you especially, welcome home. We want you to know that we see you. We see your hopes, your struggles, your dreams, and your light. And whatever brought you here today, whether you are seeking community, spiritual healing, awakening, more enlightenment, because we're already lights, but we can become brighter. We pray that you will find it here today. And we want you to know that we are not concerned about who you love. We rejoice that you love, because the world definitely needs more love. We are not concerned about the color of your skin, because all colors are on the spectrum of light. We are just very happy that you are here with us today. And we want you to know that you are welcome to stay with us at the end of service. We have our potluck today. We have plenty of food. So I hear voices. Tell them we said hi. I hear voices. Yes, God. Do you hear the voices? And we don't care if you hear the voices, although we might talk to you later about it. But seriously, we are so delighted you are here with us today. We like to laugh and have fun. As you can tell, one of our core values is fun. Before I get too much more into it, I just want to say thank you to everybody who participated in our art show yesterday, to our artists, to all of those who supported us, set up and take down, and we're here. Wow. Yes. If you are part of that team, stand up. We want to thank each and every person who made that happen. Yes. And I believe I heard you all raised 600, was it? A little right around 600 something. Yeah. And that money is for our xeriscaping that's going to be happening, I understand, starting in August. We're going to be re-landscaping out here and making our building look attractive. So thank you to everybody who was a part of that. And now let's pull out our cell phones and check in with our social media. Our check-in today is Growing Through My Paradigms. Growing Through My Paradigms. Looking out at the crowd today, it looks like that scared a lot of people. I know it's summer, it's spring, it's nice. But go ahead and check in with that on your social media. Once you have done that, you can leave your phones out and do whatever you do on them, but please put them on Do Not Disturb. We appreciate that. And now I would like to turn it back over to Martine Backman, who is going to share some announcements. Well, actually, I guess I'm going to share the first announcement, aren't I? I get to do the first one. Wow. As you know, next Sunday we begin our spring adventures in faith. We are basing it on the book Living Untethered. We are in the process of finalizing all the workbook material for our facilitators, and there will be a facilitator meeting and a host meeting, since all the hosts are also facilitators, right after service next Sunday. Now, if you would like to join one of the home study groups, the table in the foyer has all the signups out there. Michael will be at that table immediately after the service to help you. There are 6 in-person groups and 1 virtual group. So people, there's either 6 or 8 spaces in the houses, depending, I guess, on the size of the house. But the virtual group is unlimited. So if you can't get into the personal study group in your area, go ahead and sign up for the virtual one. And the last virtual class meeting group will be in person and on Zoom here in the sanctuary. So that will, or somewhere, that will be a hybrid one. So make sure you sign up today. At the table in the back, not now, immediately after the service. Okay, Martine?
Okay, thank you, Gordon. All right, we have a membership class. We do this every few months, and Gordon is going to lead our new member class, which will cover Unity history, principles, beliefs, and a wide variety of topics. If you would like to learn more about Unity and Unity principles, this is the class for you. And even if you've been coming here for a while but haven't taken the class, highly recommended. It will be a very good day. Starts at 9 a.m., goes till 4, and it includes lunch. But you must sign up in advance so the materials can be prepared for you and we can order lunch for you. And there is a sign-up sheet in the foyer for you. Okay, we are going to keep it short today, but we have lots more information regarding classes, events, etc. Please go to uscabq.org for more information, or you can access our Facebook page on the website. And we also have a Thursday online newsletter. You can just open up and read all about it then too. or call the office if you need more information. Okay, let's introduce our worship team today. Oop, there we are. Okay, you've met Reverend Gordon Kyler. Janice Harula is our board president and the trustee of the day. Yay! I'm Martine Bachman, your platform host. And our prayer chaplains today are Susie Orchard and Roland Reese. And they will be stationed at either side of the sanctuary immediately following the service for anyone who would like to do one-to-one prayer. Todd Lowry is our music director. And our USC band today is, along with Todd, is Brian Griesmeyer on guitar, and Sharon Eldridge, and David Craig's got the Sunday off. And our soloist today, Bill Brooks. Okay, and let's welcome Janet Harula.
It's good to see everybody this morning. I heard, yes, that there was a lot of people here, and I think it was Lori that was saying that one of the people came in and purchased something here that wasn't part of this community. And so we're just blessing everybody. We're blessing the artists. So we're just going to keep on doing our thing in this community. You can't hear me. I'm going to pull it closer. So please join me in saying our mission, vision, and core values. Our mission: we inspire spiritual growth through honoring many paths, education, sacred service, and abundant living. Our vision: we center in love, we see our harmonious world of divine expression. And our core values: we are Christ-centered, loving, inclusive, joyous, uplifting, open-minded, and fun. And our credo: we believe all people are created with sacred worth. We serve all people in emotional and spiritual ways. We welcome the diversity of all. God and unity leave no one out. And this is the part of the service where we gather our thoughts and our prayers for everybody, and also our giving. So the ushers are coming forward. There's several ways you can give today. You can give in person during the Sunday service. You can do it 24/7 on your Church Center app if you have one of those. You can also do it online on our website in the upper right-hand corner when you get to the website. And you can also do the phone text to give, 84321. And you are also always able to drop a check off at the office during the week or mail it in. So let's do our blessing. Divine love, as me, blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive.
Here's a little offering music.
I never read it in a book, I never saw it in a show, but I heard it in the alley on a weird radio. If you want a drink of water, you gotta get it from a well. If you wanna go to heaven, you gotta raise a little hell. Never felt it in my feet, I never felt it in my soul, but I heard it in the alley, now it's in my rock and roll. If you wanna know a secret, you gotta promise not to tell. If you wanna get to heaven, you gotta raise a little hell.
never thought it'd be so easy, never thought it'd be so fun, but I heard it in the alley, now I got it on the run. If you wanna see an angel, you gotta find a way. If you want to get to heaven, one more time. If you want to get to heaven,
thank you, music team. Now, please join me in reciting our prosperity blessing. In a universe overflowing with the allness of God, all the needs and desires of Unity's spiritual center and those we serve are bountifully met. From every direction, known and unknown, expected and unexpected, our abundant good is here now. Thank you, God.
All right, it's time for a congregational song. So I invite everybody to stand up. We're going to sing How Could Anyone Ever Tell You, which is happens to be the theme song for the WOW group. Anyway, here we go. We'll do it two times, I think.
How could anyone ever tell you you were anything less than beautiful? How could anyone ever tell you you were less than whole? How could anyone fail to notice that your loving is a miracle? How deep you're connected to my soul.
Let's do it again.
How could anyone ever tell you you were anything less than beautiful? How could anyone ever tell you you were less than whole? How could anyone fail to notice that your loving is a miracle? How deeply you're connected to my soul.
Thank you. Short and sweet.
In this very room, there's quite enough love for one like me. And in this very room, there's quite enough joy for one like me. And there's quite enough hope and quite enough power to chase away any gloom. For Spirit, God's Spirit is in this very
room. The word of the day is joyous. I joyously celebrate life. The principle of joy is always ours for expressing gladness, happiness, and joy. Each new day is a treasure hunt filled with opportunities to see and experience those things we respond to with joy. In her book, Joyful, Ingrid Fettel Lee calls this joy spotting. Life's gems are found in even the most ordinary moments when I pause to notice the wonder that surrounds me and is in with me. I let my gaze linger as I watch the setting sun or close my eyes as a savior, the sweetness of fresh fruit. I wake and praise each new day and feel newly alive. The beauty of the world pales in comparison to the beauty within me. I am so deeply and wondrously joyful to know that I am fully divine and fully human. I joyously celebrate life.
And as we feel that joy, we turn within. Filling our entire being with the joy of life, the joy of adventure. Breathing into our heart space. We contemplate the title of today's lesson, Hell in the Hallway. It is said that when one door closes, another opens, but it's hell in the hallway. And I ask God, what is that? Is it something to be feared, something to be avoided, or something to be entered into in joyous expectation? Joyous expectation of a door ahead that is opening, of paradigms that are shifting. Sometimes in the midst of the journey, it may feel like hell. It may feel chaotic. It may be difficult to see where I am going. But I know that as I step out in faith, putting one foot in front of the other, I am divinely guided, divinely supported, and that each next step is clear. Yes, it may be hell in the door, in the hallway, chaotic in the process, but there is always light at the new door as it cracks open wider and wider. As I prepare to enter into silence, I contemplate what will happen when I am through the hallway. What will the new door look like? How will my paradigms have shifted? Certainly, I will be at a higher level of vibration. And in silent meditation, I prepare. Breathing in, breathing out. I say thank you, God, that no matter what I may be experiencing in the hallway experience, I know that I am divinely protected, divinely guided, and that as I enter a new room, I remember that right here, right now, in this very room, there is more than enough love for one like me and for all who travel.
In this very room, there's quite enough love for all the world. And in this very room, there's quite enough joy for all the world. And there's quite enough hope and quite enough power to chase away any gloom.
For Spirit, God's Spirit is in this very room.
Bill Brooks is here, and he has a song called I Didn't Know My Own Strength.
Lost touch with my soul. I had nowhere to turn. I had nowhere to go. Lost sight of my dream. Thought it would be the end of me. I thought I'd never make it through. I had no hope to hold on to. I thought I would break. I didn't know my own strength, and I crashed down, and I tumbled, but I did not crumble. I got through all the pain. I didn't know my own strength, survived my darkest hour. My faith kept me alive. I picked myself back up, held my head up high. I was not built to break. I didn't know my own strength. Found hope in my heart. Found the light to light my way out of the dark. Found all that I need here inside of me. I thought I'd never find my way. I thought I'd never lift that weight. I thought I would break. I didn't know my own strength, and I crashed down, and I tumbled, but I did not crumble. I got through all the pain. I didn't know my own strength, survived my darkest hour. My faith kept me alive. I picked myself back up, held my head up high. I was not built to break. I didn't know my own strength. There were so many times I wondered how I'd get through the night. I thought I took all that I could take. I didn't know my own strength, and I crashed down, and I tumbled, but I did not crumble. I got through all the pain. I didn't know my own strength. I picked myself back up, held my head up high. I was not built to break. I didn't know my own strength. I was not built to break. No, no. I got to know my own strength.
Thank you, Bill.
Churches, you have been taught for thousands of years that hell is a bad thing.
Hear me now. Oh, yeah, much better. Thank you. It's all hell, right? As I said, hell is not something to be feared. It's not even really something to be avoided because, first of all, in Unity, we don't believe in hell as a place you go after you die. It's an experience we have now. It's the experience moving through chaos, and chaos is caused when shift is happening. Old systems, old paradigms have to be broken down so that new ones can be created. A higher vibration can be created. And it may feel like hell when we are going through it. Anybody ever gone through that? Yeah, it's not always fun, is it? Well, the book was entitled Hell in the Hallway, Light at the Door. And it's from the expression, when one door closes, another opens, but it's hell in the hallway. But there is always light. We are always moving through it, not stuck in it, unless we choose to be. We can remain in it as long as we want. I believe that Homo sapiens, us, have our experience has been a hallway experience. We're a hallway species. We're always in that process of growing, of changing, and of course, throughout our history, we have always been taught, avoid change, avoid pain, avoid discomfort. And certainly we don't want to be in pain and discomfort, but there is a place for discomfort. Discomfort is that energy of saying change, grow, evolve. If we get comfortable, it's nice for a time. It's okay for a time. But hopefully we reach a point where we say, I've been in the hallway long enough, and I'm ready to evolve into the next level. I'm ready to go through that door with the light. The series that I have tacked this on to the end of was originally a four-part series. It was based on the book, The Spiritual Laws of Prosperity by Edwin Gaines. And the first Sunday, we looked at the law of tithing, about putting ourselves in the flow of energy in every aspect of our lives, in our relationships, in our health, in our wisdom, and yes, even in our financial and material supply. We learned the principles of being in that vibration, being in that flow of energy, of expansion. We learned what a tithe is and what a tithe is not. The next Sunday, we learned the principles of goal setting and that goals are the receptacles for divine ideas. They are the concrete steps we take towards our vision. Without goals, there can be no movement. If you missed any of these, you can go back online and watch them. A couple Sundays ago, Reverend G.O. Downer talked about the principles of forgiveness and how forgiveness allows us to release our attachment to the past, to what did not work or what is not working, to be in a consciousness of no blame, which frees us from bondage. And then we looked at the principles of finding our divine purpose last week and commitment, being committed to our crucial role as a human being, as an evolutionary being, being committed to move beyond our comfort zones, to set goals, to forgive, to put ourselves in the flow. And as I looked at that series, which was supposed to be four Sundays, I thought, there's still something missing. There's still a block. Throughout the years, we have observed that these principles, while wonderful, don't seem to be enough. And I came to realize that the block is, what do we do with our paradigms? Reverend Geo talked about paradigms and paradigms. What is a paradigm? Well, that's what we're here to do today, to get very clear on what a paradigm is, where it comes from, and how we can embrace it and change it and elevate it to a higher level, a higher vibration. So let's begin with, what is a paradigm? Well, if you look it up in the dictionary, it says, a paradigm is essentially a set of beliefs, concepts, or assumptions that collectively form a framework through which individuals perceive, understand, and interpret the world around them. It is those ideas that have formed your worldview. Not just a single idea, but rather a comprehensive worldview that shapes how we think, how we act, and how we make decisions. It goes on to say, paradigms influence everything from our personal beliefs and values to societal norms and even to scientific theories. They act as mental models that filter and organize information guiding our perceptions and behaviors. But here's the important thing. Paradigms are not fixed, nor are they immutable. They can evolve over time. We can consciously shift them if we so choose. As we encounter new experiences, insights, or evidence, we can recognize that our paradigms can be crucial for personal growth, innovation, and progress. We can't allow it to challenge our existing beliefs so that we may adopt new perspectives. You know me, I like to look up the meanings of words from their original roots. And I trace paradigm back to the Sanskrit root, which meant to point out or show. To point out or show. Could it be that our paradigms serve as guiding indicators, directing us towards what we must embrace, what we must engage with, what we must change? In a much later Germanic meaning of the word, it meant to teach. To teach, rather than to fear or hate our paradigms, let's look at how we can shift them. And while paradigms do indeed shift and change naturally, I believe sometimes we get stuck in them because they are so pervasive. They are so ingrained in our cultural and societal DNA, and yes, even in our religious DNA. There's one paradigm in particular that I believe is so ingrained and so pervasive that it's high time we root it out and we heal it. And that is the paradigm that we as a species, especially in the Western world, have around abundance and prosperity. You would think that after 2,600 years of the teachings of the Buddha, after 2,000 years of the teaching of the Christ, after hundreds and hundreds of years of teachings of all the great prosperity thinkers, that we would have mastered it. That we would not be lacking, that nobody would be homeless, nobody would be starving, because we know there's quite enough supply for every human being. And there's quite enough supply for us not to be in bondage, financially or materially. Despite the best efforts of so many teachers, a paradigm has been built that has blocked us from that great realization. And as I said, it goes back even before the time of Jesus. By the time of Jesus, a solid spiritual principle of abundance had been corrupted. That originally it was the principle of tithing. And that was an act of putting a portion of your good into circulation, into the flow of spiritual energy. And for thousands of years, it worked. It worked. We know that ancient farmers right here in the Southwest put aside a certain amount of their grain to plant a part so that animals could thrive. There's a ranch in northern New Mexico called the Bolac Ranch. Anybody ever been up there? If you get the chance, go. Many years ago, Tommy Bolac had an idea because the farm that they had was right on the San Juan River, and the geese and the bugs were eating all his crops, and he didn't want to use insecticides. He didn't want to use poisons. And he said, what could we do? And he said, what if we set aside one-tenth of our fields for the animals? Would they then let the other 90% of our fields thrive? It worked. It still works. Farmers come from all over the world to study how they do it. It works. By the time of Jesus, though, the spiritual practices had become corrupted as a way to make the temple hierarchy very powerful and wealthy. On Palm Sunday, Michael shared the story of Jesus walking into the temple and turning over the tables of the money changers. Do we really understand what happened there? Do we really get it? Let's pretend that it happens today. Let's pretend you walk into your church, not this one, but you walk into a church somewhere, and you are not expected to give, you are required to give a portion of your tithe, a portion of your good. But here's the rub. Not only are you required to do it, you have to use special money. So you come in with your $5 or $10, and you hand it to somebody up front, and they take that $10 and they give you a special $1 bill back. It looks different. It's not legal tender anywhere else. And then you have to go in and you have to buy it something to sacrifice using that special money. How is that working? The idea had been corrupted. It was no longer about putting yourself in the flow of divine good. It was about a way to make money. Jesus recognized the hypocrisy of that. And so he turned over the tables. But it went further than that. That was the beginning of the paradigm. But it went further than that. Imagine that you say, okay, I want to create a religion. And you create a religion that's all about sin, shame, and blame, and teach your people that it is good to be poor. Do that for thousands of years. And voila. You have created a very powerful paradigm. You can modify it a bit if you want. Because after all, after a while, the temple priests and everything become quite wealthy. Well, what do we do with that? It's good to be poor. Unless God really, really likes you. If you are wealthy, it means that God really likes you, but Joe over there, no, not so much you. And so you gradually, through generations and generations and generations of this programming, we adopt an idea that we are worms, not so worthy as to gather up the crumbs under the table, as we used to pray in the church I grew up in. No wonder we struggle with abundance. No wonder we struggle with prosperity. I've had to deal with it myself to get past that paradigm that was a false teaching from the beginning. No wonder we have so much abundance. I mean, so much baggage around abundance, around poverty, around churches. So let's get clear. Let's set this record straight. Tithing works. The principles work, period. I've been doing it for years. It works. But only if it is done properly and with the right understanding. I know many times I have done it without understanding, especially in the beginning, where I've given my tithe without really knowing or understanding what the purpose is, what the spiritual practice is, and I haven't prospered. And I talk to many, many people as a minister. They say, well, I tithed once. It didn't work. I understand. I get it. I've been there. Because we don't understand the principles and because we have this massive paradigm that we've come up against. Imagine you're walking down the road and there's this big dragon there. That's your paradigm. What do you do with it? Well, I love an old story from the East that says there's three things you can do with a dragon when you encounter it. You can stand and try to fight it, but they have armored like scales and sharp teeth and claws and they breathe fire. You're gonna lose, and you taste good with ketchup. You can try to run, but they can fly. They will catch you. Or you can embrace them, and they become your friend and you take on their power. That's what a paradigm is inviting us to do, to embrace it, to understand it, to take on the power of it. And thus rise to a higher level. So back to tithing, back to putting ourselves in the flow of divine supply. Even if you do not believe in the spiritual principle itself, putting any part of your life into the flow of energy always produces positive results. And when we talk about this in unity, we're talking about holistic abundance. We're talking about relationship. We're talking about love. We're talking about health. We're talking about a little less pollen in the air. Excuse me. When we put whatever energy it is into circulation, the results are always positive. There's actual scientific evidence that this is how the universe works. Physicists are now discovering that this is how the universe works. It is the underlying principle of growth and expansion. Charles Fillmore wrote this: "You may be thinking that you cannot give because your income is small or your supply of anything is limited, but your remedy is to cultivate ideas of abundance. Claim God as your inexhaustible resource, that all things are yours. But in order to set in motion the accumulated energy of your thought, you must also take action. You may be able to only give a little bit at first, but give in the name and the spirit of God. We do that. We change, the wording has changed a little bit over the last 125 years. But the principle is the same. But our paradigms get in the way. I've seen so many people that, you know, when they become aware of this, it triggers it. There's a trigger that happens. They fear the very idea of doing it. I've been there. Anybody else? You don't have to raise your hands. But if you've been there, you know what it feels like. And you want to run from it. Or you want to resist it. Or you want to blame somebody else for your paradigm. That's the easiest thing to do. Well, he did. He made my paradigm. It's not me. Maybe. But we are the ones who get to heal it. We see it happening to us as individuals. We see it happening in our nation. Right now, that's what's happening. Paradigms are showing up to be changed. Societal paradigms, economic paradigms, political paradigms. We are in hell in the hallway right now. But that's okay, because that hallway does lead to an open door. This is nothing to be ashamed of. We are the ones who have been called to shift the paradigm. It is a great honor. It is a great invitation. So how do we do that now? Now that we understand really where our paradigms about abundance and prosperity come from, how they've been built over centuries and centuries of programming, how do we shift it? Well, first we have to understand that any issue involving lack is an expression of a paradigm around abundance. So we look at the lack of housing for people. There's more than enough housing for every human being. We look at hunger. There's more than enough food for every human being. There is no reason anybody should be experiencing being unhoused or unfed. We know that. So why is it not happening? Because of the paradigms. We know that we live in a limitless universe, that there's no shortage of resources. There's no shortage of love. There's no shortage of food. There's no shortage of shelter, and there's no shortage of money. And until we can recognize that kingdom of heaven consciousness, we will not shift the paradigm. Now, we think of kingdom of heaven, maybe if you grew up in a traditional path like I did, kingdom of heaven is, you know, streets of gold and pearly gates and all of that. Kingdom of heaven is an ancient way of saying fourth dimensional thinking, fourth dimensional vibration, higher than our normal way of seeing and understanding things just through our physical eyes and our physical interpretation. It's an understanding that we are energy, that all creation is energy, and energy can be shifted, energy can be channeled, energy can be directed. So the second thing we have to realize is to overcome prosperity paradigms often involves in a shift in mindset and behavior. It means embracing a more holistic perspective on prosperity. So how then do we do that? Well, the first step we can take is reframe prosperity. Reframe that word. How many of you still feel a little angst when a minister says prosperity? Yeah, I hear a few kind of hesitant uh-huhs. It's okay. It's okay. Rather than solely equating prosperity with material wealth and possessions, expand the definition to include elements like health, relationship, personal growth, and community well-being. I like that last one. Community well-being. Recognize that true prosperity encompasses a balanced and fulfilling life in every aspect. Second, and this one's most important, practice gratitude. Cultivate a sense of gratitude for what you already have. This can help shift your focus away. I lost my tape. This can help shift your focus away from always wanting towards appreciating the abundance that surrounds you. I feel grateful every morning when I'm driving into work and I see my mistress on the horizon. Novella calls Sandy a peak my mistress. My mistress of convenience. I literally say to myself, thank you, God, for letting me live in New Mexico. And when I look at Novella, I say, thank you, God, for sending me to Missouri and allowing me to come back. Are we grateful all the time? There's always something to be grateful for. Even with all the pollen that's in the air right now, we can be grateful for the beautiful flowers and plants that are going to grow. So cultivate a sense of gratitude for what you already have, because this can help shift your focus away from always wanting more towards appreciating what you have. Regularly reflect on the things you are thankful for, both great and small. The next one is simplify your life. Evaluate your lifestyle and identify areas you can simplify in. It might involve decluttering your physical space, reducing unnecessary commitments. I say learning to say no. Sometimes that's a very important skill to develop. Or cutting back on excessive consumption. By simplifying, you free up time, resources, and mental energy for the things that truly matter. Michael, would you hand me the other mic? I don't know where it is, but thank you, Martine. Prioritize experiences over possessions. Instead of pursuing material wealth, prioritize experiences and relationships that bring joy and fulfillment. Invest in activities that align with your values and contribute to your overall well-being. Whether it's spending time with loved ones, pursuing hobbies, or exploring new places. Prioritize experiences over possessions. The next one is practice generosity. Embrace a mindset of abundance by giving back to others. This could involve volunteering your time, donating to causes you care about, or simply performing random acts of kindness towards others. Generosity not only benefits others, but also fosters a sense of connection and purpose within yourself. When we do something for someone else, we are building an energetic bridge. We are coming into a consciousness of oneness. Next is focus on your personal growth and invest in your own development. Set meaningful goals that allow with your aspirations and constantly strive to learn and grow. Cultivate mindfulness. Develop mindfulness practices such as meditation, yoga, journaling, tai chi. We have all of those available here. Mindfulness can help you become attuned to your own thoughts, emotions, and behaviors. And finally, and this one might surprise you, maybe not, connect with nature. Connect with nature. We live in one of the most beautiful places in the world, in my opinion. Spend time outdoors and reconnect with the natural world. Nature has a way of grounding us and showing us what truly matters. Whether it's going for a hike or a walk in the park, gardening, a picnic, immerse yourself in nature because it can help you develop an appreciation for life's simple pleasures. When we can embrace these ideas, these principles and practices, we gradually begin to shift from a narrow prosperity paradigm focused solely on material wealth toward a more holistic and fulfilling understanding of what prosperity is. And when we have one area in our life that is lacking, it's a reflection of the entire consciousness. So as we work on this stuff, we're healing the whole spectrum of what prosperity is. I like what Jesus is quoted as saying in Luke, "Stop concerning yourselves about what you will eat or what you will drink, and stop being distressed, because it is the unbelievers who are concerned about all these things. Surely your Father knows that you need them. Instead, be concerned about his kingdom, and these things will be provided to you as well. Stop being afraid, because your Father is pleased to give you the kingdom." Now let's bring that up into modern terminology. Jesus, that time, they did not have the same understanding of quantum physics and quantum mechanics that we do, but that's what he was talking about. So let's restate this. Stop worrying. Stop it. Worrying is negative energy. Let your consciousness be fourth dimensional. In other words, align with the vibration of the universe, the kingdom. Put yourself in the vibration of abundance, and all that you know that all you require is at hand and will become manifest. The universe is only about expansion and increase. That's how Jesus would say that today to us. The universe, of which you are a part of, by the way, you're not just in it, you're a part of it. It is about expansion and increase. James Lewis wrote, "There is no need for some to have abundance and others to have nothing. There is more than enough of God's good for everyone, for this is an opulent universe." It is high time we shift that last paradigm that is blocking true abundance consciousness for ourselves as individuals and for all humanity. It is time we embrace the paradigm, for it has a gift for us. Margaret Ponder, the Unity minister and great teacher, wrote, "God is the master composer. We are his musicians. He has given us his most beautiful score and limitless access to the instruments of abundance. You are a musician. You have a song to sing. You have a symphony to play. And it is time to sing a new song, a song of limitless abundance." Namaste.
One of our favorites. You can spend your whole life building something from nothing. One storm can come and blow it all away. Build it anyway. You can chase a dream that seems so out of reach, and you know it might not ever come your way. Dream it anyway. God is great, but sometimes life ain't good. And when I pray, it doesn't always turn out like I think it should. But I do it anyway. I'd do it anyway. This world's gone crazy, and it's hard to believe that tomorrow will be better than today. Believe it anyway. You can love someone with all your heart for all the right reasons. In a moment, they can choose to walk away. Love them anyway. God is great, but sometimes life ain't good. And when I pray, it doesn't always turn out like I think it should. But I do it anyway. You can pour your soul out singing a song you believe in, that tomorrow they'll forget you ever sang. Sing it anyway. I believe it anyway. I do it anyway.
Thank you so much, Bill. There's kids out there.
You can walking in the light of God. You are 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 walking, 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 walking in the light of God. You are walking, 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 walking in the light of God.
Good morning, everybody. Happy Sunday. So good to see you all, and happy Cinco de Mayo. We have somebody, we have somebody that's eager to share.
So we played some games today, and it's also someone's birthday, which is honors.
And today we took pictures. There's two little birthday penguins. We took pictures. And it was very fun.
So I did a picture where I had Noah and me. It's this one. It wasn't the smaller. It's in the has the small the pink the small penguin. Noah's face is at the small. Noah's the smaller penguin, and I'm the bigger penguin, the taller penguin.
Hi, I'm Teddy. Our lesson today was about gossip, how there's good and bad gossip. If it's gossip about how you can help someone and stuff, that's good. Bad gossip, it's bad. But we did a lesson how gossip is sometimes never good, because if you do gossip, it can spread and change. So one was Alex smells neat, and then it became like Alex smells rice. Like rice. So gossip, it's not good to do because it can change and be something bad.
So we mentioned gossip. The main part of the lesson was to be impeccable with your word and how your word can create and destroy your universe. We're all messengers of God, and we should use our word to not hurt others or ourselves, but to help.
That was very beautifully said, Saya. Thank you. Okay, anybody else want to share? Tessa? No? Okay, I want to share. Sarah brought in some amazing stuff for her birthday celebration for Honor. It's so cute. There's like a little, like they were saying, you can take a photo as a penguin with another penguin friend, and there's a game in there, so we'll be doing that after church if anyone wants to see. Other than that, please join me in blessing these wonderful people.
Yeah, it is birthday Sunday.
Yes, does anybody born in May stand up?
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Unitix. Happy birthday to you. God is blessing you now. God is blessing you now. God is blessing you. You're wonderful. God is blessing you now.
And don't forget to sign up for an Adventures in Faith group after we pray out and sing the peace song.
The love of God enfolds us. The power of God protects us. And the presence of God watches over us. Wherever we are, God is, and all is well.
Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me. Let there be peace on earth, the peace that was meant to be. With God as Creator, family all are we. Let us walk with each other in perfect harmony. Let peace begin with me. Let this be the moment now.
Right now!
With every step I take, let this be my joyous vow.
Woo-hoo!
To take each moment and live each moment in peace eternally. Let there be peace on earth, and let